you grinding, Glenn.
Yeah.
This is the part we're going to grind.
Okay.
Now, let me explain to you why this part should be jig ground. Let's supposing that we're going to put a hole in here.
Okay.
Now, we could do that with a bridge port, right? Or drill press.
Yeah.
Right? But.
Or even hand drill if you're really desperate.
Or with a hand drill. But if you want closer tolerances, a drill press won't work. You'd go to a bridge port, right?
And why the drill press won't, too?
Well, because it doesn't have that same kind of precision. You'd have to bore this with a boring bar.
Right, okay.
So, let's supposing that you wanted it to be closer than a bridge port. Now what would you do?
Jig grind.
That you would. Now, let's suppose that you could, with a bridge port, maybe, or a jig bore, you could get the hole close, let's say, within a couple of tenths.
Right.
There's one problem. If this is hardened, that ain't going to happen, is it?
No.
You got to grind it. There's no choice.
Okay.
So now here's the challenge. We've got to grind this hole within plus 2/10 minus nothing.
Wow.
That's the size. To further complicate it, we've got to hold the size and we've got to hold the distance, what we call from the center line of this hole, down to this face.
Okay.
And ultimately, we want 100 thousandths from here to here, plus a couple of tenths. So we've got a series of problems.
Okay.
One is holding size, and another one is holding this dimension from here to here.
Okay.
The only way that you can do that is jig grinding. That's how you're going to get this piece that we're going to take out there, and we're going to grind it.
Okay.
We're going to show you how we do it, how we set it up.
Right.
And how we're going to end up with this hole being within a couple of tenths and with the center line or whatever you want to call it, either from the bottom of this hole to the face or from the center line of the face, one and the same.
So when you're setting it up, you're figuring out where that center line
is. Well,
that's
all been calculated into it, right. So I used a set master. I used one of these that was already done. And I did what's called tramming. So I trammed it with the indicator and I got it nice and straight and right to the right, to the left, back and forth.
Okay.
And I knew that it was just going to be where we wanted it to be. And then we're going to take it out there and we're going to grind it. So we're going to show the folks how we did it. So you ready to go out there and give it a shot?
Sure, do I need this?
You need that. That's the hole we're going to put in here. That's our hole. You just took our hole away.
I got a hole in my hand.
Let's go back out there to the jig grinder. Let's go. Okay, Glenn, we've got this shoe ground here.
Yeah.
And as you may recall, we're going to go ahead and grind this ID.
Okay.
And we're going to hold that to a really tight tolerance, a couple of tenths. And as I think we mentioned earlier, we have to hold it from this face to the center line within 2/10, plus hold the size of the hole.
Right.
So it's a little bit tricky. So the way we're going to do it is I've already indicated this face of the V-block, so I know it's parallel with the ways. So now I'm going to take this and clean this surface off pretty good and put it up here and clamp it like so. And we're going to talk about clamping and tightness because it's really critical. If you tighten it too much, we're going to make the hole out around. And I know you wouldn't think the steel would bend that much, right?
No.
Well,
I never thought it would.
Let me get an Allen wrench here. I always wonder who this guy Allen was. I'd like to meet him someday.
I think his first name's Tim, isn't it?
Tim Allen, that's it. Yeah, they named the wrenches after him, right. All right, so look how much I'm tightening that. Not a lot.
Not much. Finger tight.
Almost finger
tight.
End
of the fingertip.
Right. Okay. Now, I changed this bit. I put a coarse bit in here, and we're going to, after we get this thing close to size, we'll change it again and put a fine bit in there.
Okay.
So in the meantime, we've got to make sure that that we're set up right. So that allows me to move it up and down. Now, I know that that's going to hit the hole.
Right.
So I have to back this off and make sure that we don't hit it.
So when you do each part, you got to go back to step one.
That's correct.
Yeah.
That's exactly right. See, now I know we're touching right there.
Mm. Okay.
So we've got to take it back some more yet. We're not touching there now. Now I'm going to put the oscillator on for a minute, which is what that does.
Yep.
And we'll see if that touches anywhere. Nope, we're good to go. So we can start it, and we'll make sure that our stops are set right. So we'll let this baby go up and down. And
do you have the air on?
Does should
it make
be
a difference?
Yeah. Oh, I know why. Got to put it on auto. Duh. That helps every time.
Yes, it does.
Well, you got to remember, I'm not used to running this machine, so.
Well, that makes two of us. Anybody want to help?
A little bit outside my my ability here, but we'll try to make this work. I love doing things like this when I've never done them before. I think we got it set pretty good. Okay. So we'll go ahead and put the spindle on.
All right.
I'm going to feed this baby in until we start touching. There we go. Now, once I clean it up, I'll go ahead and check it and see where we are.
Okay.
But I want to make sure that we get the hole hit, all, is hitting around all over.
Yeah. It's only hitting the backside right now.
Yeah. There we go. It's starting to hit the rest of it. I'll tell you what, this new bit is doing some work.
Yeah, it is. The other one's leaving marks are
yeah, it was like almost looked like a thread in there. That baby's pulling some stock out of there fast. As I recall, we had about 25 or 30 thousandths in there.
Yep. Can this thread bolt this machine?
No.
It's not used for that.
All right, now it looks like it's starting to clean up. I'm adjusting this travel in the bottom.
When you say travel, it's for how down?
Yeah, how far up and down it goes. There's no point having it go down too far, then we're just wasting time. It's just grinding air, as I always like to say. No point grinding air, right?
Yeah.
And
like
I make any money.
Waste time, 5 seconds
right.
Each time.
That's right, it's a lot. You add it up at the end of the day, you're talking a lot. So always try to tweak it and...
Even more, ended up at the end of the week.
That's, or the month of the year, right?
A couple, 3-4 hours,
that's right.
10, 20 hours.
You got it. All right, so one more pass, and I think we can give this a check and see where we are. Again, we're not concerned about the finish. The finish is going to be pretty rough.
Okay.
Yeah, I like that. So what we'll do... I'm going to let this spark out just a little bit and take a check now and take a visual check and make sure that the finish is what we want, that it's not, we still don't have some grooves in there from this coarse bit. And I think it's cleaned up, but I don't know that. So we'll raise it up. We'll take a good look.
I still see some lines, but
yeah,
they're
so
really
do I.
Fine, they're very fine.
See where we are in size.
So now I've gone from not seeing lines to know how to see the lines.
What kind of lines? You mean Detroit Lions?
Lions.
Well, we got about a thousandth and a half to go. Maybe two thousandths right in there. A thousandth and a half to two thousandths. Remember, anybody can do it. You guys can read mics within a few tenths if you just practice with it a little bit.
Micrometers?
Micrometers, that's it. So we said about a thousandth and a half, so... There's our thousandths right there.
All right, so you're compensating for both sides, right?
Right. And then I'm going to back off just a bit and watch it, how it's going to change. Look at that.
Oh, wow.
Isn't that amazing?
That's incredible.
And it's darn near finger tight. And I could almost loosen this with my fingers.
Right, but it still blows my mind because it's a piece of steel, and I'm thinking,
you're thinking it's not going to bend that much, right?
Steel is steel, man.
It bends, man, believe me. And there was hardly any pressure on her, but when you're trying to hold size within a couple of tenths, you can't put much pressure on it.
That's incredible.
I mean, most guys would probably...
They have machines to put a little felt on it to hold it in place sometimes.
Well, that's not going to stop it from warping, is it?
Oh, I don't know. I just thought maybe...
No, you're going to push on it, you're going to push on it, you know?
Yeah. So much room on the dock before you get pushed off.
That's it.
You water skied, yeah?
I did.
I love water skiing.
Yeah, I haven't done it in years, but yeah, I used to water ski a lot. In fact, I'd get up out of bed and I was gone, man. I was on skis.
Last year, I thought I still knew how to ski, and then I hit the water. Oh boy, that hurt.
You got about a thousandth to go, or maybe a little less, but right in there, which is perfect. So we wanted to get that out of round condition out of there.
It's like even real big pieces of machinery that you have to hold in place, you have to kind of take in mind that
always,
you're squeezing it with the clamps.
With the clamping. You got to keep that in mind anytime you're working with clamps. So remember, folks, when you're out there and you're cranking on stuff, you're going to distort it. Metal is metal. It's not something that doesn't bend. It bends.
How much water does metal have in it, like this piece?
I would say none.
None?
No water. No, there's no moisture in it. With cast irons like this, supposedly that absorbs a little moisture, but I don't think it's... That's not my area of expertise, but
right.
I wouldn't think that...
I was told that all metals have an X amount of water in it.
Well, that's possible.
You know?
Not something I know a whole lot
about.
Maybe
our viewers have that answer.
Yeah, I bet you they do. Somebody does.
Send us a skew or something of like what metals hold how much water.
Yeah.
I know my damn razor blades hold it and they get real dull.
Yeah, my electric razor does that too.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Well, we still have a couple of tenths to go. I'm showing exactly about 2/10 minus. So I'm going to let it spark out. I'm not going to feed in much. Whoops, wrong nozzle by, boy.
Damn newbies.
Yeah. See, now that's probably taken off maybe a tenth or so, but I'm going to feed it in just a little bit, maybe a couple of tenths.
And you know how they came up with the name NASCAR?
Well, how?
Two guys are racing tractors down in the south. Guy pulls up in a really nice Camaro and they look at it and go, hey, NASCAR, want to race?
Go to your room, man. That's awful. And don't come back. All right, so I think as I watch it spark out, it's taken off a couple of tenths, but it's not taken off much. I'm going to slow it down a little bit and let it take a slower pass. This controls the speed of the vertical travel.
Okay.
So I think we'll get a little better finish doing it that way. Comes back up, we'll...
Now, say you're stuck and you got to finish a few more parts and your bits are getting dull. Does that heat it up more? So you got to kind of like watch out for it warping and stuff?
Yeah, it could. Yeah. Absolutely. Uh-oh. Sorry, I'm busy. Can't take that one.
Want me to get it?
I guess she doesn't know we're out here, right?
No.
Let's see what that's like. I guess I should have told her.
Mm-hmm.
I would say that that is probably 1/10 plus. Now, we're going to shut it down because we're good. I want you to watch when I loosen this, how loose that really is. Watch this.
It's not even an eighth of a turn.
There's nothing.
It's really...
Now, it's either done or it's not done, right?
Right.
So we'll check it with the bore gauge now.
All right.
So let's see what we got here. First of all, we're going to set it with a master. Straight.
Yep.
And round. You got it there, buddy?
Yep.
That's right on size. So there you have it. Now what we're going to do is we'll take it up front. Let's check it on our magic machine and see.
Oh, the little thing that goes beep, beep.
That's it.
Beep. What is that called?
Heightmaster.
Heightmaster.
But I like it.
We have a video about that, don't we?
We do. Look at that.
Yeah, the Heightmaster is pretty cool.
I'm pleased with that, man.
That is sweet.
Up. Oh, that's it. Let's go. Time. Just in time. Let's go. All right, good job, man. Let's get out of here. Hey, Tim.
Hey, Don.
Tim Allen. The real Tim Allen, not the fake one. This one's the real Tim Allen.
The real tool, man.
So, Tim, what we'd like you to do is give us a check here on Suburban's new Master Height, right? Height Master?
Master Height.
Master Height. Master Height. Right, yeah.
Color screen.
Beautiful.
It's nice, all touch screen. You got touch
awesome probe
for you want to move the probe. It's all touch. Got an air bearing.
Beautiful.
So anyway.
So what we need to check here, Tim, is we need to check the diameter.
Okay.
Instead of diameter, but the diameter.
All right, we're in England now.
All right, and then we also have to check the distance from the bottom of this face to the center line.
Okay.
So if you would, please, we got to see what where that's going to fare.
It's pretty simple. It's one touch. It's going to come up, touch off on the top.
Yeah.
You let it find its center.
Yeah.
Okay. Our diameter is 610 thousandths and 2/10.
Perfect. That's what I measured.
And our height to the center is 405 4/10. But the other dimension that's really critical on this part is that the distance from the bottom here to the underside.
Face, okay.
We got to be 100 thousandths, really plus 2 or 3 tenths.
Okay.
So that we can lap this in for our gauge surface.
Let's
on
see
the
what we got.
Again, one touch. Let it find itself. There you go. 100 thou and 3/10. Right on the money,
baby.
Don. Good
right.
job, baby.
All right. Good job.
Glenn, what a job we did, eh?
Yeah, for newbies.
Yeah, perfect. Great. So there we go. All right. So now we're going to go into the other room, and we're going to talk about what we just did. We're just going to review it. Right, Glenn?
Yes.
Let's go in there.
Okay.
All right.
Did you like that?
It was cool. I even
was
got to play
cool?
with the machine. That was nice. I call it playing with the machine, because anytime
yeah,
I do something
yep,
new, it's
yep.
playing. It's...
Well, as you saw when we inspected the part, that this thing was right on the money. So
yeah.
It's not that hard to do with a jig grinder. Now, you couldn't do this, as we mentioned earlier in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
You couldn't possibly do this on a bridge port with a drill press or a hand drill. You can't hold those kinds of tolerances.
No.
And again, this is hardened steel. But I think what was most fascinating was the fact that we put so little pressure on here.
That
and it caused
surprised
it to
me.
Go
that
out
really
around,
surprised me because we messed up a part. We had to throw it out.
That's right.
I think that's edited out. I'm not sure.
Doesn't matter. It's all good now.
Yeah.
So I'm really pleased with the way this came out. And again, using a rough bit to get it close and then putting the finer bit in and
right.
finishing it, no question that saves a lot of time and saves the wheels. Because those grinding wheels are about $65, $70 a piece.
Really? Those little,
wheels,
the little
yeah.
tiny bits?
Wow. Yeah, they're basically a diamond bit.
Okay.
And that's why they're so expensive. And they're also very precision.
Yeah.
They're not elongated. You know, they run nice and true.
Mm-hmm.
So there we have it. And we want you folks to keep an eye on this video. Pass it along to your friends. We've got more jig grinding stuff coming up, and I'm really excited about it because we went out on YouTube and on the internet. We couldn't find anything
You asked me to go look, and I went home, and I got tired and started falling asleep.
Well, you do that when you're working.
I didn't think he caught me.
Well, only twice. That's okay. So anyway, tell your friends about us. Tell them to subscribe. Give us a thumbs up. We're going to keep teaching. We're going to keep showing you lots of ways to learn things and to save money if you apply them. So
if I can learn it, you can
get right. He's a newbie. This is a guy that he's really a guitar player. He's not a machinist. So it's great to have him here, and not knowing anything about our trade, and to be able to show him some of the things, and he gets it. So he does. So Glenn, thanks for coming once again.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching. We'll see you next time around.